Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Molly Silberberg, and I organize BAM's humanities programming. Thank you all for joining us tonight for this program to launch A Little Devil in America, Notes in Praise of Black Performance by Hanif Abdurraqib. Tonight's program is part of Unbound, a series celebrating new releases by renowned authors, artists, and public figures. Since fall 2012, BAM has partnered with independent Fort Greene favorite Greenlight Bookstore to create spaces for audiences to engage with creative and incisive voices, reflecting on art, culture, history, and some of the critical questions facing society today. We're grateful to our partners at Greenlight for all of their work to help make this evening and this series possible. And we are truly thrilled to be hosting Hanif Abdurraqib and Wesley Morris this evening to celebrate this stirring meditation on Black performance in America. There's no shortage of praise that I could share about this book or either of these two incredible individuals. We're also very excited that Hanif has joined the BAM team as a guest curator at large, where he'll be programming music and envisioning cross-genre performance. Before I go any further, I want to acknowledge the land that I am on today and on which BAM's physical buildings are located, which is the unceded land of the Lenape people. I acknowledge Indigenous stewardship of this land and honor the Lenape elders, past and present, as well as future generations. A few logistical notes. Tonight's program features ASL interpretation and captioning. If you are looking for captioning during tonight's live stream, it is accessible via the stream text link posted in the chat. Thank you so much to Antonio and Benjamin for interpreting and to Jamie for captioning. We'll begin with a reading by Hanif, followed by a conversation between Hanif and Wesley. We will then have time for questions at the end of the discussion, which you can ask by typing them in the chat. And check out the chat for more information about how to purchase A Little Devil in America from Greenlight Bookstore at a discount and receive a signed bookplate while supplies last. And now I'm honored to briefly introduce our guests for this evening. Hanif Abdurraqib is a poet, essayist, and cultural critic from Columbus, Ohio. His poetry has been published in Pen America, Muzzle, Vinyl, and other journals, and his essays and criticism have been published in The New Yorker, Pitchfork, The New York Times, and Fader. He's the author of 5 acclaimed publications, including 2 full-length poetry collections, The Crown Ain't Worth Much and A Fortune for Your Disaster, and 3 collections of essays, including Go Ahead in the Rain, Notes to a Tribe Called Quest, They Can't Kill Us Until They Kill Us, and the now released A Little Devil in America, Notes in Praise of Black Performance. Wesley Morris is a critic at large at the New York Times and a staff writer at the New York Times Magazine. He co-hosts the podcast Still Processing with Jenna Wortham. For 3 years, he was a staff writer at Grantland. Before that, he spent 11 years as a film critic at the Boston Globe, where he won the 2012 Pulitzer Prize for Criticism. He lives in Brooklyn, New York. And now it's my pleasure to turn the stage over to Hanif Abdurraqib.
Hey, everyone. I hope everyone is, I can say all the things about how weird it is to be talking effectively to myself. But hopefully knowing that people are hanging in and doing okay. I'm in a rush to talk to Wesley. So I'm gonna read, not for long, I'm gonna read a few sections from a piece in the book called 9 Considerations of Black People in Space. And I'm gonna jump around a bit, but I'm gonna read maybe 4 of them. And thanks for being here. And thanks to BAM, and thanks to the interpreters, and of course, thanks to Wesley Morris, who is a hero and a friend. 9 Considerations of Black People in Space. To be fair, I cannot claim that I love the moon as much as all my pals and ancestors and peers. I maybe do not love the moon as much as other poets who seem to love the moon for what it is capable of doing to the waters or how it seduces the best or worst out of an astrological sign. I don't know much about astrology, but I do like the idea of astrology for what it brings out in my most creative and magically inclined friends. Alyssa, leaning eagerly over a table to ask me if I know the exact hour and minute of my birth so that we might do my natal chart and finally get down to the issue of what's going on with all my emotional rattling about. Madison scrolling furiously through her phone over a dinner to see what phase the moon is in or what planets are twirling ever more maniacally out of whack so that she might explain to me why all the furniture in my heart's most precious corners has been overturned. Still, I can't say I'm much into what it all means, just that it means something, that we were all born under a different moon and a different sign, and I believe in it, I think. I have taken to waving a dismissive hand and telling a friend, that's such a Virgo thing to say, even when I'm not entirely sure what I mean, and no one has corrected me yet. So either I'm right, or I've surrounded myself with immensely kind people, which is probably a very Scorpio thing to say. And besides, Robert Hayden loved the moon. And what a fool I would be to not love what Robert Hayden loved, to not drink from whatever his palms offered. Robert Hayden so loved the moon that he decided to strip it of its magic entirely. So it was just the hanging and cratered glowing rock tasked with dividing up the darkness. And I too dig the moon most when it is a question of its functions, how, for example, I might have once slid underneath it in some alley on a clear night to better see the face of a dear brother or to skim a phone number scrawled onto a napkin after spilling out of some dive. I wish to view the moon as Hayden viewed the moon, an object that has a purpose rooted primarily in how it shines and little more beyond that, but still, I know that Black people in this country have long been obligated to a love for the moon, especially the enslaved who had to traverse the otherwise darkness in a search for freedom, aligning directions with the way the moon fell and following the shapes of the stars. And so even if it is sometimes a bit of a show off, every now and again puffing itself wide, sometimes blushing a gentle red, I do get the affection for the thing, even when it is dragging me out of the house, interrupting a romantic movie night, bending into the potential for more romance so that we can all go outside and stare. Then again, who am I to judge? I've picked through my own closet and opted for the crushed velvet or the bright red on a day when I am dressing for someone else's wedding. I've shown up to the high school reunion in sneakers that have cost more than I made in a work week of slinging books. So I suppose we're all the moon sometimes, depending on the occasion. While we're here, though, I have to say that I also know nothing of the stars, but have lied about what I know many times. On the television once, a boy traced the constellation of freckles on a girl's face, then pointed at the sky and she gasped with joy. On a walk in my real life, holding hands with someone somewhere, I pointed up at the stars and pretended to know the shapes of them and said something about eyes and a promised future. And the person I was with laughed. So, okay, I suppose I don't know the stars well enough to lie about them comfortably, but I did have a telescope once bursting out of my top floor window during a time when I lived in a city that got less clogged with smoky haze during its nighttime hours. And I would look into it every now and then, watching for all the shapes that everyone else saw, but with no luck. From under a campfire, my friend Corinne said, "It's easy. The Big Dipper is right above us." And then she traced it out with her fingers. But all I saw was a series of tiny explosions that never vanished. 4. It is true that my beloved mother did not live long enough to go to space, and even if she'd had the opportunity, she likely wouldn't have made the trip, but she did have an afro, and on the days she'd get home from work and take off her hijab, she would sometimes pick it out and let it sit high for a whole evening, and from a distance, it looked like an entire black planet, and she'd sometimes sit sway in the kitchen and sing Miss Patti LaBelle, but never really the old Patti who in the early 60s toured through the Apollo Theater with Nona Hendrix and Sarah Dash and a group that would come to be called LaBelle once the labels got a hold of them. LaBelle could sing, but that was only the half. And the other half was about the look, which they didn't always have. When they first started, they fumbled through a series of wigs that didn't always match their heads and sometimes drooped down during their most energetic performances. But in the early 70s, they dipped a toe into the UK and started wearing tight jeans and massive afros while cashing in on some of the more political soul music on the of the era. And in 1973, the group was spotted by designer Larry Legaspi. And I don't know when or where I first saw the video of LaBelle in those silver space suits. I want to say I first saw the clip of them singing Lady Marmalade on Soul Train, but it might have been the clip of them singing the song on Bert Sugarman's Midnight Special. Both of the performances took place a few years before I was born, but I do remember watching them on some old and creaking VHS with a label that had been written on and scratched out and then written on again. Under the eye of Legaspi in the early 70s, each member of LaBelle had their own unique space look. Sarah Dash had a silver crop top with wide rounded shoulders and silver shorts, finished off with a pair of high silver platform heels. Nona Hendrix had a silver suit with an elongated diamond design dripping off the shoulder pads and stretching down to the pants. Herself wore a silver jacket with a massive consuming collar and silver platform boots stretching almost all the way up to her waist. This wasn't their only look, but it was the most memorable. On the nights they didn't take to the stage draped in their spacesuits, they did it drowning in massive feathers, leaping out from every angle, from atop their heads or flaring out from their backs. Some nights they would mix it to aesthetics, accenting a space-themed top with bright, massive plumage. And in the most striking photo I recall, the trio is shot in black and white. Patty is in the center, flanked by Hendrix on her left and Dash on her right. The picture is from sometime in the mid-70s, after LaBelle had their big breakout number one song with Lady Marmalade. In their subsequent album, Nightbirds became a hit. In the photo, Patty's hair, thick and wavy, rolls neatly along her head. The light in the photo makes her black hair glow. Nona's face is painted with a triangle of small dots starting at the top of her forehead and then dancing down to her eyes, which are accented with eyeliner that sparkles even through the photo's lack of color. Sarah's eyes are covered with feather-like jewelry. They are all wearing the half smile and half determined look that I'd known the black women in my life to wear before. It would be hard to know if they were smiling at all if not for Patty's overabundantly defined cheekbones and Sarah's dimples, which didn't need much temptation to make an appearance. I found a framed version of this photo while antiquing once in a place where not many black people traveled, and I assume even fewer black people lived. I am mostly assuming this because I couldn't imagine any other reason the photo lasted that long in the shop, especially for the price it was listed at, a paltry $2 when rung up on the loud and rattling register. I kept it on my desk in three homes. I realized that what I like most about the photo is how, in the moment, they do truly look like astronauts, like perhaps underneath each of their arms might have been a helmet. In the videos of all their performances during the spacesuit era, I marvel even now at how smooth they made it all look. Wearing all that heavy silver, adorned in all those feathers, they still move the way they did in their jeans and black sweaters. I think when you are young enough and impressionable enough, and you maybe don't know much about what rests beyond the stars, you imagine anyone can just go, including yourself, or including a music group of black women who wore the costume well, including a person you love who sang along to songs by a member of that group from time to time, and surely danced to the group in a time before you were born. I guess I have tricked you into reading about my mother again, and how I do not know if she wanted to go to space, but how I still wanted that for her. How, from time to time, I would catch her gazing at the stars. How, of course, I've held that old LaBelle photo close because it reminds me of a sky my mother might be occupying now, picking out her black afro until it blooms and blooms in endless dark. No one I love is immune to looking upward on a clear night within the vast and open possibility of darkness, though. I had hoped for a people to find a home, or at least a dream. LaBelle, grinning in the width of their space suits, singing songs about lonely and powerful women, songs about children going to space. I'll stop there. I was going to read another part, but I'm just so excited to talk to Wesley. So let's get to it.
Hi, Hanif.
Hey.
How are you?
I'm all right. How are you doing?
That
you
was great. Wonderful. Take a drink. Take a drink. Yeah. Thank you. You look great too. Speaking of looking great, who's that? But is that Millie Jackson behind you?
This is Millie Jackson behind me. Thank you for noticing. It's in Shaka's here, and Martha and the Vandellas. Okay. Yeah, Martha and the Vandellas are here, and Little Richard and Wire. There's no photo on the Wire album, so it's just like a, you know. But can I tell you something about the Martha and the Vandellas record?
Tell me anything you want.
So I got this.
Are they wearing afros?
They are. So this is the last. This is like the final Vandella's record,
okay.
Black Magic. And I got it from, shout out to Spoonful Records, my hometown record store. I got it from there. And I noticed that it was a UK pressing of this record, which is not, it's pretty rare. And so I was like, can I pay y'all more for this? You know, I was like, I saw the sticker. They're charging $5 for it. I was like, can I pay you more for this? And they're like, no, take it, whatever. I get home and the lighting won't work, so people won't be able to see this. But on the back of it, Sandra Tilly signed her name. So it's like a signed copy. I feel like I stole this, essentially, is what I'm saying. Reparations comes in many forms.
Who knows how they got it? So, right? You know, wow, Martha and the Vandellas in that era too.
Like, I know.
When Berry Gordy was finally like, okay, I guess you can wear an afro. You can get as close to natural hair as I'm going to allow you to get.
And I love Martha Reeves. I think in a different era, not to reduce Martha Reeves, but I love her as an artist, but also I were like alive in the 70s, I would perhaps have hollered at Martha Reeves.
Hello? Yeah. Yes. But I have to say, like, you've made me choose. And I didn't know that. I mean, the Millie Jackson thing is what I got hung up on. But now that you've got this, like, very valuable Martha and the Vandellas record behind you. But I feel like Millie Jackson is somebody who, if you don't know about Millie Jackson, please go discover, because she was filthy in the most delightful possible way. You know, that album, that's an Imitation of Love, right?
It is.
And, you know, I don't know, wait, what, that's 86, all right. So 86. Tina Turner did Private Dancers before this.
Right before it, yeah.
But I'm just so interested in, like, Black women on album covers in the 1980s. And how everybody had their idea of sexiness.
She's got on like a blazer and like a sexy wedding dress.
Yes.
And this is like maybe one of the more tame Millie Jackson album covers.
This is a woman whose album Back to the Shit
is her on the toilet.
Back to the is her on a toilet. Yes.
I mean, without Millie Jackson, there's no like Adina Howard, and there's perhaps, or like Lil' Kim is perhaps differently presented, right? Like, I just,
there's, she's no, the genesis TLC of so much mail.
Yeah. Millie Jackson doesn't really get her roses, and she's really someone who's at the center of so much of like Black sexuality that I grew up understanding but didn't know. Like, I grew up in the very much in the, like, the other day I was joking about how when I was a kid and Lil' Kim's Hardcore came out, I was like 12 maybe, and the whole thing was everyone around me was like, you can't listen to the album, it's, you know, too. And this thing happened in my neighborhood where a lot of us would just dub the album onto a blank cassette and then write something else on the blank cassette, like gospel tunes or whatever, you know, like,
well,
Kirk Franklin or whatever we could get
gospel to somebody. I mean, that's a free Black woman and her sexuality is, you know, historically complicated, but just to sit with it in the moment of itself is so exhilarating. And for me, the first person, I mean, I think Millie Jackson really is the first person I experienced this with because of the album covers. Like, they were just in my dad's house and I'm like, what is this? And you can take a second, because this is a virtual situation. People watching, you can hear us talk, but you can look up Millie Jackson.
Up Millie Jackson.
But you know, you sort of, a lot of this book in many ways is you doing what you literally say with respect to some people. Merry Clayton, for instance, is an example of like just giving flowers to these people, just giving them a do that they haven't been given. And I was just, this book seems to go in a lot of different, it's all going in the same direction, but it seems to, it could have started in any number of places, because there are strains that run through it. And I was curious about what strains you were aware of wanting to bring up to the surface enough to be apparent to a reader in order to arrive at some kind of theme.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think this idea of partnering which I didn't realize was so prominent in the book until I finished the book. Because, mm-hmm. you know, the book mm-hmm. opens with that essay about Soul Train and dance marathons, which is yeah. actually, though it only gets maybe like a paragraph or two, that essay is actually about the challenges and miracles of partnering with a person. It's in just the Soul Train line is a vehicle for that. And it's like, of course, it's in praise of Don Cornelius and in praise of Jermaine Stewart, who's from the east side of Columbus, and all the Soul Train line dancers. And it's in awe of this horrific spectacle of the dance marathon. But really, it's about this idea. I don't want to be too romantic about the dance marathons because they were horrific. But yes. I was so fascinated when I researched them with this idea that a lot of the people or some of the people weren't taking their romantic partners to these dance marathons. It was like, that's the boy from the hardware store, or that's my neighbor's kid, or that, because it was like a woman would be like, it's a sport. Yeah. It's like, I need a man who's strong enough to hold me up, but not so heavy that I can't hold him up.
Yeah.
And that's like a wild thing to think about when someone is dancing with you for 1400 hours. You know,
marathons are crazy.
And so I think there's a theme in the book that I wasn't aware of. And this perhaps leans into my worst impulses, which are the fact that like I'm a romantic who can't kind of control that, even mm-hmm. when I'm trying to meander through other things. I think my romantic impulses still leap to the forefront. And so the essay about spades is also about partnering in a very yeah. literal sense, but also yeah. a very romantic sense. Yeah. And you know, so much.
I mean, that moment with Whitney Houston at the Grammys that you talk about.
It's about partnering.
Like the moment that she feels, that she seems to us, to the viewer, to feel most comfortable at those, like the 87 Grammys or the 88 Grammys, is the moment where she comes back out on stage after that intermission. And she is partnered with this Black man to dance with after dancing not so great in the first half of this number of I Want to Dance with Somebody.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, your partners.
I think that's just, I feel like, unfortunately, that's just going to be the way my brain works until I'm done. Because I am so consumed by the idea of, one would think that this would maybe make me good to date, but I think it has an inverse effect where it's like, it's probably horrific because I'm meandering through all the possibilities of partnership that can both be miraculous, but that can also be treacherous.
Sure.
I feel like my brain is kind of in a hamster wheel of that. And so writing, I can't help but bring myself, you know, the piece that's about like softness is kind of gets its spark from Ghostface and Raekwon sharing that kiss in the Triumph video. Mm-hmm, and everything flows from there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, to that end, like having there be things in the book that you kind of, I'm curious about what you, where you were conscious of doing, you know, because I don't know if you feel this way, but a lot of the writing process for a lot of people is kind of, and you know, another theme in your book is kind of magical, right? There are things I can set out to do when I start to write. You know, I can have a goal in mind with respect to a thesis and some structural ideas. But once your brain starts doing what it's doing, you don't really have a lot of control over it. And, you know, over the process of drafting things, you can get to a point where you can see what's happening, but it isn't necessarily that you set out to do it. So I'm saying that to say that I'm wondering if you're aware of how travel functions in your book.
No. Not at all. I mean, I guess there's the green book thing.
Hanif, you're always going somewhere in this book.
Am I really?
You are physically... I mean, I started to keep track of all the places you were going. Let me see if I can find them. Let's see.
Oh, you have a list? Is this like that Johnny Cash song, I've Been Everywhere, where you're just like rattling off places?
Yes, but you actually have been everywhere. But I mean, I had a question about this. So you're from Ohio. And, you know, this is, I would say, very quietly a book about travel. So you pop down to Louisville. You go to Little Rock. You go to a barbecue place in Memphis. You're writing about the Green Book. Which for anyone who doesn't know is not a movie, or not just a movie, it's a movie. Well, the movie thinks it's about the actual Green Book, but F that. It's the problem with the movie. But you go at some point, you go into great detail about what the Green Book was. Anyway, I'm just wondering what travel has to do with the way you look at things and how it's clearly so much a part of who you are that you don't even know that you're not always aware of the fact that it's playing the role that it's playing in at least in the writing in this book.
Yeah. Now I'm thinking about it in all my other books, particularly the tribe book, where I write about like taking a road trip to Odessa.
Yep. I mean, I'd factor that in. Yep.
I think it's that thing where I was young, you know, I came up in the Midwest punk scene in the early 2000s, which means that just inherently you had to travel. Now, not saying there wasn't punk in Columbus, but you know, you'd see all the bands. And so you go down to Dayton sometimes, but essentially you'd have to try like make a trip to Detroit or Chicago, sometimes Louisville, sometimes Pittsburgh. You kind of built a diamond shape of places you can go. And so I just have a relationship with the road that is almost second nature. Then in 2019, I did like 110 readings. And so I was on the road all of the time. Mm-hmm. And I used to take road trips just to do it, you know?
Right.
Because I believe that there's something fascinating about witnessing a place that is not your place, that you don't have a desire to stay in.
Right. You know? Yeah.
But you still, in that lack of desire to stay, I think opens up a sense of wonder for me. Because it's like, I don't want to stay, but I want to see everything while I'm here.
Yeah.
And so I think in my writing, I kind of pursue that unintentionally, but I, you know, I'm someone who kind of wants to be and will get up and go to a place on really slow input. Not now, of course, I'm in the house, but forever. But, you know, I remember.
Hopefully not forever.
Yeah, not forever. But I remember like when Alex Chilton died and his funeral was in Memphis. And I was like, well, I'm going to go to Memphis. I loved Alex Chilton and I'm going to go to Memphis to, you know? And I think that my writing kind of has these impulses too, where so much of the population of the piece is kind of malleable. You know, the geographic population is really malleable.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, what did it mean then to think about what the Green Book was doing as a Black traveler who frequently travels by car? What was it about? Setting aside you didn't even finish the movie because it was so appalling to you. So God bless you. But what does it mean to you? Like, what did the Green Book bring up for you as a person who is often on the road?
I'm thankful there is a more sophisticated highway system in America now than there were, you know, because a big part of the Green Book or the function of it was that the highway system was different. And so much of travel was just on roads and on back roads.
Right.
But, you know, I also just know, I don't want to disparage Ohio too much because I think this is a microcosm of the country, but I know Ohio's geography so well that, you know, I'm in the capital city, I'm in Columbus, but if I go in maybe like 30 minutes in any direction, it's a little less welcoming of a space for me personally. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And you pick up things, you pick up signs. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it is the person in like a Confederate flag jumpsuit. But sometimes it's just like the feeling and the lack of comfort that kind of washes over a space that has not been touched by or present with Black people for a long time. I'll tell you what though, when I lived in the Northeast, I lived in Connecticut for like 2.5 years, that went way out the window because everyone was racist. I was like, what is happening? You know, like, sorry to disparage Connecticut, but.
I went to school there for 4 years and lived there for like 6 months after school. So I understand. I've been all over Connecticut. I've seen a lot.
It's rough. It was hard for me to map. Yeah. It was hard for me to map out like the many modes that I've accepted racism can appear in, and to live in Connecticut and be like, oh, there are other modes. Mm-hmm, incredible. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah. I mean, there is a part of me, I don't know if I go to Maine pretty often, and I've been to, you know, I just feel like in this country, we have this, you know, historically based illusion based on how the Civil War worked out in terms of, you know, the sides. That, you know, one side of the country is like safer than the other side. Yeah. But I believe the farther north you go, the further south you are.
Yeah. I mean, I love this. I mean, I think like so much, you know, I think most of the Black people I know, particularly in the Midwest, have some roots tracing back to the American South. And that is just a place where I've been comfortable. I mean, like some would consider parts of Ohio, Southern, like Cincinnati is to me, a Southern city, you know, and I love Cincinnati deeply. And you know, the South is a place of great comfort for me, and specifically parts of Alabama and parts of Mississippi are just of great comfort to me. Like not so much Oxford in a way. Like I remember recently, one of the last readings I did in public was at Square Books, and which is a beautiful bookstore. Oxford is fine. Okay. But I remember kind of like walking down a street with a homie, the great poet, Julian Randall. And he had lived there for a while. And I was like, yo, there are plantation houses everywhere. Just everywhere. Like they're closing in on us. And he was, you know, he was kind of like, oh yeah, you get used to it after after a few months. And I, you know, but I will say that like parts of Mississippi and Alabama and in Louisiana are just really great comfort spots for me. Texas too, of course.
What is it about those spaces that is speaking to you?
I think, and Tennessee, Tennessee is absolutely South, but I think there are parts of those places where slowness and simplicity are comforts to me, especially when it comes to Black folks that I've known and been around and come up around, you know. And a few years ago, I guess it was 2 years ago, I took for the New York Times, I did this piece where I took a road trip with a photographer, great photographer, Andre Wagner.
Oh, sure.
We started in Baltimore. And we ended up in like South Carolina, but in the meantime, we kind of just drove the American South. And it was so wonderful to see, you know, and our task was to write about and photograph Blackness as it existed along the southern coast and a little bit inside the coast. And it was so wonderful to me to see Southern Black expression be as multitudinous as I know it is. And for us to kind of chase after this, where Baltimore, there's like, you know, we're at a skating rink at 3 a.m. and, you know, in Savannah, we're like following a high school, all Black high school to their first football game, and these kind of things where the pace of life and the kind of warmth that comes with that pace. And I think there's a level of knowing of the land that also kind of warms me a bit.
Mm-hmm. I mean, yes. I mean, ancestrally, it's our land.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
In a lot of ways. But conversely, you know, what you read from before we started talking was about, in some ways, you know, you're talking about space and, you know, outer space, and the ways in which we Black people have found themselves there. I mean, you talk about Lando Calrissian, you talk about, that unforgettable photograph of Trayvon Martin in that space program. It's a sweatshirt, right?
Yeah, he's wearing like a button-up type thing. Yeah, the experience thing.
And LaBelle, of course. And, you know, I've always been struck by what happens in the 70s and the moment at which you start to get, I mean, Afrofuturism becomes like a major concept, but also just, you know, Afrofuturistness, right? Like people like Parliament and Earth, Wind and Fire really talking about space in this way. Sun Ra obviously is another person you mentioned in that piece. Can you talk a little bit about like what drew you to want to think about Black people in this particular way? I mean, some of it feels clear, but I'm just wondering, I just want to hear you sort of ruminate about that some more.
Yeah, I had like so many of these pieces, especially the ones that are kind of like intensely sectioned off, like this one and the 16 ways of looking at Black race. It was like the one thing. And I was like, I'm just going to write a little bit about this one thing. And weirdly, in this piece, it was the Lando Calrissian thing. Because I was thinking about Billy Dee Williams and how when I was a kid on the school bus, he was one of the voices that I knew really well because Colt 45 ads would play in the mornings on WVKO. Shout out to anyone who is from Columbus and watching this if you remember WVKO. And he was the voice of Colt 45. So before I knew him as Lando Calrissian, I knew him as like the voice of Colt 45.
It works every time.
that it works every time. Well, yeah, works to, and then, like, looking back, it's like, works to do what, Billy? You know what I mean?
It's pretty clear in the commercials what it works to do.
Yeah, sheesh. Billy D, although I think he's, Billy D has evolved in his later age. Yes. I think he said some thoughtful things on gender, I believe, that I was moved by, if only because I did not know he was still with us. Thankful that he is, though. But I kind of went to this idea of, and then I found LaBelle photos. Like, I found the photo that I had had, but then I found so many photos of them performing and so many videos of them performing in these spacesuits. And I just couldn't get enough of this idea of LaBelle, who, if we're being, like, honest, and I love LaBelle, love Patti LaBelle, love Nona Hendrix, love, like, I love LaBelle. But if we're being honest, like, they didn't really get their groove album-wise until Nightbirds. And then they kind of, like, lost it immediately. Like, Nightbirds, it's so fascinating to me. Like, Nightbirds is, for me, one of the best albums ever made. But none of their other albums are, like, a fraction of Nightbirds. It's just so puzzling. Because they're talented.
There were some good songs, like System.
Yeah.
Which is a masterpiece, I would say.
It's just, like, they couldn't figure it out.
Right.
And so I kind of wanted to honor that era of LaBelle. And then I found myself writing about Robert Hayden. And at that point, I was like, I think there's something here. There's the bones of something here that I'm curious about. Mm-hmm. And it is how to tie together this fascination with space as it relates to Black people eager for something other than here. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. an eagerness to kind of ascend to a place different than this one. And of course, in the piece, I talk about Octavia Butler too, and, like, her vision for an other world that is, like, violent and unkind, but still another world, you know, sometimes violent and unkind, not always, of course.
Right. But an alternative to this place.
Right. Yeah.
And, like, a leaving behind, like a necessary shedding of trauma. I mean, this essay really, I mean, it gets at all those things. And, you know, having it be nine parts felt planetary to me in some way. I don't know if
that thank you for noticing that.
Okay.
No one else has mentioned that.
Well, I mean, you know, you put it on the tee, we just smack it off. So another thing that I'm really curious to talk to you about too. Well, first of all, I wanted to start here truly, but Millie Jackson distracted me. This book cover
is
a fantastic photo. Of, for anybody who doesn't know, this is the Lindy Hop, and this is Leon James and Willie Mae Ricker. Doing one of the most incredible dances anybody. I just want to know. I mean, I don't know how responsible you were for choosing this image. You obviously okayed it. And the book is about dance in so many ways. What is it about the Lindy Hop that is speaking to you? Or, I mean, well, first I would ask, A, what is it about the Lindy Hop that's speaking to you? But also, how is dance functioning in this book according to you?
Yeah, well, one, I have to say proudly, I was very responsible for the book cover. Perhaps too responsible. Thanks. I mean, endless gratitude to the Random House design team, because there were points where, like, you know, we thought we had a finished cover. By we, I mean, like, I was like, that's the one. And then I would go to bed, you know, and then I wake up the next morning and email me, like, that's not the one.
Oh, wow. Okay.
There was this great, great, great photo of Josephine Baker that was going to be on the cover. But I ended up having some, like, complications with it. You know, it's this picture of her kind of, like, ecstatically jumping in the air and her arms are spread wide and her head is up.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, I don't know if, you know, there's something that is a photo I would love to have in my home out of love for Josephine Baker. But on the book, I felt some complications about the way it kind of sexualized her without showing her face, you know, because her face was, like, up to the sky. And because when I first saw the photo, I was like, this is an amazing feat of athleticism that I want on the cover. But then when I saw it on the cover, I was like, oh, but it's also doing this other thing. Yeah. And I knew, but I wanted something that kind of captured Black people in the midst of something spectacular. But I also wanted at least one face present, because I wanted a face that was expressing awe at the fact that they were doing something they knew was miraculous. And Willa Mae Ricker's face in that photo is so amazing because she's kind of like, I cannot believe we're doing this. Yeah, it's the best.
It's have you ever tried to Lindy Hop?
I have not tried the Lindy Hop.
Because several days over the last year, I've been down a Lindy Hop, Jitterbug, Charleston, Cakewalk rabbit hole. And these are just, people used to just, and these were dances people were doing en masse, like in nightclubs that seemed to go on for miles and amid thousands of people. Men and women, and sometimes women and women and men, just tossing bodies in this space with complete control and total joy. And I don't know where did that, I miss that. That is a thing that I deeply miss.
There's gotta be a place. I didn't
even experience it. Like,
there's gotta be a place you can Lindy Hop. There's gotta be a place somewhere.
You can take a class, but just the images of people in these clubs doing this dance, and many other dances during the swing era in the 1930s and 40s is mind-blowing. And to see just this woman's face, and that's what everybody looks like in this footage. Everybody looks like they're having the time of their lives. So what is dance doing for you in this book?
So I had begun, the book, the thing that really reformatted this book and made it a different book than it was when I set out was spending a ton, like hundreds of hours watching Soul Train. I'd gotten a hard drive every Soul Train episode from like the 70s to the 80s. And so I just watched them all.
Yeah.
And I had begun in a different world. If I could share my screen, I would share like two examples of Soul Train lines that shifted. Because one big thing about watching Soul Train lines evolve from the 70s to the 80s was that this thing would happen in the early 70s where if the song was right and the groove was like really high, the line would just deconstruct. There's this video of where Love Train is the song. And at first it starts out with people moving down the line. And then you can see like people starting to move down a little quicker and quicker and quicker, and people kind of starting to crowd in the middle. And by the end, it's just like bodies are everywhere. Right. Yeah. And then this thing happens in the 80s, by the time you get to like the mid 80s, there are fewer partners in the line. There's way more solo dancers. They are way less concerned with propulsion. They're kind of like, how long can I stay in this one spot and milk my camera time?
Jermaine Stewart,
really. Who I love.
Yes, Jermaine Stewart, for everybody who might not know, we don't have to take our clothes off to have a good time. Oh no, that's Jermaine Stewart.
Columbus, Ohio legend. But I've been thinking a lot about, and I recently talked to the brilliant Erica Blount Danois, who wrote a wonderful book on Soul Train, and she said something so succinct that made so much sense to me. Okay. She was like, Hanif, it is hard to dance on beat while moving forward, like while actually propelling yourself forward and to maintain being on beat. And I was like, well, so frankly, Erica, I would not know, as I am a mediocre dancer at any stage of movement. But it made me think about, watching all of that made me think about the way that I view dance as something that does not necessarily require another person's presence, but instead requires a desire for closeness or a desire for a type of synchronicity that you perhaps cannot reach on your own. And that's why, like in the chapter about beef, I'm talking about what it's like when the romantics of the pre-fight, I remember coming up when I would get in a fight, there was always a thing where you're like in the person's face and you're making eye contact and you're like circling each other. And as I get older, I'm thinking that's like intimate. There's an intimacy to locking eyes with someone and waiting for them to move towards you, even if violence is at the end of that.
Yeah. You also mentioned though, that style of fighting means there's not going to be a fight.
Right. Yeah.
Right. It just means the two dudes or women are not gonna fight because they've had this other kind of intimacy and they're seeing their humanity, I think, in that moment.
Yeah.
So you can't beat somebody up who you just like have this kind of intimacy with.
And you get to a point, I remember getting to a point when I was like in my teenage years and then my like punk years, where it's like, if that's happening, there's not gonna be a fight. The fights happen without warning. You know, mm-hmm. the fights mm-hmm. happen mm-hmm. with immediacy often. And, you know, years of watching sports, NBA particularly, has also done that to me. You know, like the basketball fights, they always happen suddenly.
Yes. You know? Yeah, out of nowhere. There's no time for anything.
Yeah.
But it's been building over the course of the game, or at least, you know, or the course of a series, depending on what the circumstances are.
Right.
So there's a lot of stuff between the lines that, well, I mean, I don't watch as closely as other people do. So when these things happen, sometimes I'm like, wait, what did I miss? And sometimes we didn't miss anything.
Right. Right.
This is a split second thing.
And that feels like dancing too. I mean, so much of the high level question of dancing in the book is not even necessarily rotating or revolving around the physical nature of dance moves to a song, but it's about, again, these emotional dances and the kind of the dance of spades, where right. like yeah. I talk about how I'm not great at spades because of my eagerness to show that I can win early, which throws off the strategy, right? Which that too is a type of dance, you know, to all of these things. I think dance is the one thing that kind of undergirds the book really strongly.
Yeah. Well, I was just gonna, like, there's the dancing that you also do, you know, the interstitial parts of the book are about, I want to get the exact wording right. I mean, you can say what it, well, yeah. I mean, on times I have forced myself to dance.
Oh, those things, yeah.
Though, yes. And, you know, those aren't really about dancing per se, but they're about dances that we do. That are emotional, that are social, that are about, you know, things left undone, or positions, you know, dances between people that have nothing to do with physicality at all, right. But they're like a figurative dance. I don't know. I just there's such a mastery of. I mean, you know, you're you, but there's such a mastery here of conceptual. Language and as applied to different scenarios. Before we go to questions, I just had one more thing I wanted to ask you about with respect to one of the things that you write about in the book, the kind of performance that black people find themselves having to do with other black people. And one thing that you seem skeptical about, at least in terms of your experience, is this idea that there will be black people who wouldn't understand people's blackness that didn't conform to like the dominant blackness mode. And you've mentioned a couple times in this conversation your relationship with punk rock, for instance. You were more probably in a scene than I was. But that was music as a consumer and as a radio listener that I was really drawn to and that spoke to me. But I never had, there was never another black person to, I had my Karen White friends. I had my like, I'm your baby tonight friends, but I didn't have, I didn't have a person. There's a moment where Smells Like Teen Spirit comes on. The first time I ever heard it, I heard the last minute or so. So it's like, you know, all the buildup to a denial. And I can remember that song leaving the radio, my turning the dial every which way to try to find it again. And then I, not being able to find it, I left my little dorm room and went into the hallway to see if anybody else was going to open their door and be like, my mind just got blown.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, nobody did that. It was just me. I was on a little bit of an island, and part of the island that I was on was also, and also there also was something about, there was no Hanif. There was a Hanif at my school, Hanif O'Neill, but he wasn't.
Hanif O'Neill?
Hanif O'Neill, yeah, yeah.
Shout out to him.
I'll tell you about Hanif some other time. Hanif is wonderful. But there was no you to be my friend and, you know, love Nirvana with me.
Yeah.
And so I did feel, you know, I knew how to be conversant in blackness and like black culture, obviously, but for these things that didn't conform, just to read you talking about the ways in which, you know, Nirvana and, you know, alternative music and punk rock were you know, part of the world that you grew up in some way was just, it was heartening, but also a little enviable.
I can, well, I will say this. First off, I will be your friend and listen to Nirvana with you now, if that's any comfort. But I also, I've been thinking about that since I wrote it. And I do think that this, there's a position of privilege that is maybe generational in a way. And I know we're not like way far apart in terms of age.
We're but old, I'm older than you enough.
Yeah, right. And I'm the youngest of four. And I went through my formative years in the 90s where I think, and I grew up in the neighborhood of a lot of Black folks who either had older siblings or there were older siblings. And I went to school with a lot of Black folks who had older siblings who at that time, I think, were just exploring a lot of music, you know? Mm-hmm. And so like the first time I heard like The Clash, it was because a Black kid handed me a tape. Mm-hmm. And the punks I was hanging out with were Black kids. And which doesn't mean that I didn't get introduced to music through other avenues, but there was never, like my brother would watch Headbangers Ball after UMTV Raps. That was just, he would like watch them both. And that's, mm-hmm. you know, that's just like the first time I saw the video for Enter Sandman. And yeah. so I lensed so much of that. My sister was listening to everything. And they were no worse for the wear because of that. And so because I kind of came up in that ecosystem, it didn't ever strike me as odd that I might listen. And the people around me were not, like, sure, at my school, there were the hip hop kids who I wouldn't come up to with like a fucking Weezer tape. So I don't know if I can curse. Sorry, Bam. But there were more, there were like more kids who were interested and excited to just listen to whatever. Like I came up in a very heavy mixtape culture where people loved to be surprised by things. And that kind of continued. I was thinking about this because I was listening to, I was listening to Jeff Buckley's The Lover You Should Have Come Over version that's live in Chicago, where he just like is, oh my gosh. Beautiful. And I remember the first time I heard Lover You Should Have Come Over. I hadn't heard of Jeff Buckley until my first year of college.
Did you think he was a Negro?
I absolutely did. In part because the person who played Grace for me was one of the Black women who like lived on my floor in the dorms. And she was like, you have to hear this Jeff Buckley album. And she played Lover You Should Have Come Over first. And I was like, I was looking at the cover of Grace and I was listening to, you know, it was one of those things like, wait a minute, you know, this is maybe a Black person because he sounds like that.
Yeah.
But those kind of revelations always happen to me, largely happen to me with Black folks. And so in a way, my skepticism comes from a place of immense privilege where that's just the world I inhabited. But I also did want to turn away from this trope, because I feel like there's this trope where, not saying that you are doing this, of course, but where like Black folks are like, well, I listened to Nine Inch Nails and I got made fun of by other Black people. And I think that just sells Black people short. It sells the multitudinous nature of our living short, which it sells short the fact that, and it just truly does not reflect the Blackness that I grew up around. And I understand that these things are as multitudinous as Black people themselves. And so undoubtedly there's some privilege in that for me, but I'm thankful for it nonetheless.
I think you just had different experiences. And I think that, you know, one of the things that I was experiencing was that there were all these other different Black people in the culture doing this stuff, right?
Yeah.
And I think, you know, I went to a small school. So, I mean, that is part of it too. But anyway, Jeff Buckley was shocked to discover that he was not a Negro myself too.
Who am I thinking about? I'm thinking about Bobby Caldwell.
Oh, Bobby Caldwell. Yeah,
who's like,
it's everybody.
Yeah. It's like every year we have to be reminded that Bobby Caldwell's white.
Bobby Caldwell is number one. Like survey says, Bobby Caldwell's number one. He's the one that gets everybody. Is like, what? Okay, let's take some questions from the people who have gathered to listen to you. We're gonna take one from Austin. I don't know, Austin's a person, okay. Well, I was gonna say maybe it's from, anyway. It says from Austin, but I'm assuming, hi Austin, welcome to this conversation. Would love to hear Hanif's perspective on the music video as a medium of Black performance and how it's been perfected by hip-hop/R&B. Any thoughts? Well, this is two things, but I will give this to you, Austin, two-part question or conjoined question. Maybe, Hanif, you can join them. Any thoughts on Lil Nas X's new masterpiece are also welcome.
Second night in a row, I've been asked about Lil Nas X video. I think this, I need to watch it. I have not watched it. And here's not, and I just have been, I've been busy, you know, like.
Yes, you've been busy.
I released probably the biggest book of my life to date this week. So I've been a little busy, but I preemptively love the Lil Nas X video because it's made a lot of people angry who I believe are like fucking corny. So that does it for me, but I want to watch it because I feel like I'm going to get asked about it every single night, which I'm fine with, but I need to watch it. I am a big Lil Nas X fan. I think he has really mastered the use of the internet in a way that startling to me, not in a bad way, startling, just like, how can someone get that good at the use of the internet? Like, the light years ahead of everyone, even in his age range in some ways. Last night I was talking about the thrill of the golden era of rap music videos, which for me was like 91, 92 to 99. I don't want to disparage the shiny suit era, but I think that there was some like homogeny that kind of just fell through the cracks there with the shiny suit era.
Well, everybody wanted Hype Williams to do their
video. And I love, I mean, to be clear, I love Hype Williams, but I don't love that era of Hype Williams.
I love
the 90s Hype. I love like Put Your Hands Where My Eyes Can See. And
that's a work of art slash masterpiece slash nobody.
Hype kind of got with like, let me just put everything behind a blue filter and, you know,
Belly.
Like I was in Ja Rule, one of Ja Rule's first singles I watched recently where he's like, and it opens with a scene that looks exactly like a scene from Belly. And I was like, oh, Hype, come on, you know? But I do love Hype Williams and it, gosh, but like, Crush. I know this isn't a Hype Williams video, though many people mistake it as a Hype Williams video, but the video for Crush on You is just so amazing.
Is that Lil X?
I think that's Lil X. Yeah.
Okay.
Everyone thinks it's Hype Williams because of the colors, but it is, I think, Lil X.
But so that era of you know, 90, 91 to 99 is what you're saying?
Yeah. I really think that's where the golden era of rap music videos were for me. Yeah. And I mean, Austin is right. I think it really revolutionized like what videos were capable of in terms of like narrative tools, storytelling, videos that had interludes woven into them, you know, videos where like people really mastered short form filmmaking, like music videos which were actually just like short form films. Some corny, but still great.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. I mean, I think it allowed me, as someone who's always been a visual listener of music, to see the personalities of the people I was kind of taking in. And that was also a real gift for me.
I mean, just Rhythm Nation alone. I mean, wherever we're gonna slot Janet Jackson, but like what that album managed to do for music videos of every sort and for her as a self-expression, as a matter of self-expression, just great.
I do want to be clear about one thing. Since we've dipped our toes into the waters of Janet Jackson. Janet Jackson, wait, did we do this when you were on Objective Sound? Did we go on a Janet Jackson thing or no?
No, we were very well behaved.
She's one of the greatest artists of all time. Like I look at the discography, I see like four classics, four guaranteed classics, and maybe a fifth.
Control.
Yeah.
Rhythm Nation.
Absolutely.
Velvet Rope.
Velvet Rope, indeed.
Janet.
I think All For You. Maybe not a classic, but I love it.
All For You, we had this deep, what we thought about before we left with Stevie Wonder.
Stevie Wonder and Prince, I know.
I think All For You is the best produced of, it's better than people think it is.
Yeah.
The problem that hurt, the thing that hurts the record is right in the middle. She does that Janet slow jam thing where, you know, she and Jimmy and Terry just want to have this, you know, three or four songs.
Lock of slow jams.
Right. And, you know, the genius of Control and Rhythm Nation was those things came at the end. But on All For You, she puts them right in the middle. But You Ain't Right, Trust a Try.
Yeah.
Anyway, I,
And I will say real quick before, because I know people are like, what about my question? I know, I'm sorry. We went into a Janet thing. I apologize. But Janet, to me, has the Stevie Wonder thing where, like, the thing, the argument for Stevie Wonder for me is that, like, not only did he have a great run, but at the end of that great run, he had, like, an impossible album. And I think Janet kind of has that, because at the end, not the end, but, like, when her great run plateaus, it's Velvet Rope, which to me is, like, and no one else could have made that out. That's an untouchable album.
Yeah. Nobody. I mean, she'd been building to that the whole time.
Yeah.
And I would say, okay, so what I would say, if you're comparing Janet Jackson to Stevie Wonder, I would say that because of All For You is her Hotter Than July.
Hotter Than July. Yep.
Yes.
Definitely Hotter Than July.
Okay. Question from Becky. Which writers and artists have most impacted your use of language?
Susan Laurie Parks is someone I love a lot. I love the work of Susan Laurie Parks a lot. Zora Neale Hurston, you know, wrote, she was a writer who I first saw writing the way her people spoke. Mm-hmm. And there was a permission in that, even though I didn't understand it when I was like 15 or whatever. There's a permission in that I returned to. Of course, I mean, I feel like this is going to be a thread, but I speak about Toni Morrison all the time, because Miss Morrison is someone who just really does not get enough credit, I think, for how well, I mean, she gets a lot of credit for a lot of things, and so maybe this falls by the wayside, but how good her ear was, like, sonically.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like, what she does. People center on it with jazz, but it's all through her work. You know, her ear for what language can do when pressed up against other language is impeccable.
The opening, I'm pointing behind me because I actually have Tar Baby on, like, it's way, I can't see myself, but, like, way behind, oh, that light's out. The opening passages from Tar Baby, where she's setting up where you are on that, you know, on that island or shore or wherever you are, like, in that, in the house, situating the power dynamics among the staff and the people who live in the house. Toni Morrison, you thing that falls by the wayside, but, you know, all you have to do is pick it up and show it to people, and they're like, oh yeah, of course.
They'll see it. It's there the whole time. But also, like, you know, hella poets, Khadijah Queen, Adrian Matika is someone who's just, like, a hero of mine. One of the first poems, I started writing poems in 2011, and I didn't know, I had no relationship to contemporary poetry because it wasn't taught to me. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know what contemporary poems were like. I just knew I wanted to write about music. And Adrian Matika has a poem called Maggot Brain, which is still to this day one of my favorite poems in the world, it unspools the George Clinton line, play like your mama died. And it ends, I'll never forget the first time I got to the end of this poem because I was like, holy shit. It ends with this line, maggot brain, someone somewhere is losing a mama right now. And I was like, I can't write that, but I can write, I can, like, imitate that until I figure out how to write better. You know? I spent so much of my early poetry life copying Khadijah Queen and Adrian Matika and Terrence Hayes. And you know, those folks are important to me too.
Question from Katie. What music or performer do you wish you could have included in the book, but ultimately opted not to?
Well, there was a lot that went by the wayside in the editing process. Shout out to the great Maya Millett, by the way, who's just the best editor in the world. For me, like, I, you know, when I had my draft of this, I was like, I think, not that, I mean, Random House is more than a quip, but I was like, I kind of want to hire, like, a black person to edit it. And someone was like, oh, Maya Millett is who you got to go to. Like, it was funny because it was like, you know, I came up around hustlers who, like, always had something to sell. And it was like that again. Everyone was like, oh, Maya Millett, you know, I got the number. Just, you know, I got her email here. You know, it's like, and then I worked, and she's just brilliant and really whipped this book into shape. But in that whipping into shape, so many things had to fall by the wayside. And, you know, there was this piece on Betty Davis that I really loved that just that wasn't working. And I had to, like, admit that it wasn't working, which was hard. There was a piece on Allen Iverson that I loved that also wasn't working.
Okay.
So I had to abandon a couple things.
What was that trying to do, the Iverson piece?
I think I was, it's funny because I have an Iverson essay and they can't kill us until they kill us. And I think the problem is that it was turning the same wheels where I was just like, isn't it wild that Allen Iverson, it was about Allen Iverson and the Fab Five, the Michigan team, and about basketball and fashion, you know? It's so funny because there's a debate, you know, Chris Webber is up for induction in the Hall of Fame this year. Yeah. And there's all this debate. It's like, I don't think he's going to make it because NBA career. NBA. It's like, no, no, no. He needs to make it. The entirety of the Fab Five needs to be in the Basketball Hall of Fame. Because before, it's just what people heard. It's so, I don't know. I can go to the whole thing. I'll just try to abbreviate this. What people hear about the Fab Five, they were badder than that. You know, these motherfuckers were like the stories you hear about the Fab Five. Go back and watch some of their full games. They were talking shit from whistle to whistle, you know, like baggy shorts, black shoes, bald heads. They were scaring the announcers.
It was the bald heads that really freaked people. I mean, that's part of it too. Like the maturity and, you know, whatever a bald headed black man signifies, people weren't having that.
They weren't with it.
So last question. This is from Diana. Could you talk about structure? I had some writing questions for you, but they too have fallen by the wayside. Could you talk about structure? Thank you, Diana. You write associatively plus historically, plus I love that. How do you find the order of pieces in your books so that they move best together and the movements themselves? Book as dance. That's the statement / praise / question.
Thank you, Diana.
How do you work the structure or find the structure for the books?
This book was really Maya and I putting our heads together because otherwise I don't think it would have come out as neatly. We really like reverse engineered this thing where we took apart the first draft, I rebuilt a better draft, we took that draft apart and started asking questions about what emotional buckets things fit in and not thinking about it thematically. Mm-hmm, right. Mm-hmm. Even though I think by virtue of thinking about it holistically and emotionally, like what emotional buttons are you trying to push here, here, and here? Okay. Thinking about it like that, there are some things that thematically kind of fall into place organically. Sure. But it also leads to a thing where, you know, the magical Negro essay is right up against like another essay that perhaps doesn't fit as well, you know, like the Josephine Baker essay, I think, you know, or the space essay, where it's like these aren't thematically wrestling with necessarily similar things, but they're kind of trying to nudge, they're kind of trying to poke at the same emotional thing.
Oh yeah, I mean emotionally, I think Diana's question is a great one in that like the structure of the book, the themes are in the structure, right?
Right.
I mean, again, there are the things that you know, and then there are the things that just come up because they're in you. And, you know, one of those things is travel, which we talked about, this idea of ghosts and vanishing and remembering. I mean, a lot of what you're doing is rescuing people from, if not outright obscurity, then certainly from being underrated in some ways. I'm a big believer that there are so many great people that we think are great. Just like what you said about Toni Morrison, there's this thing about her that we don't give her credit for.
Right.
Chris Webber. Obviously great basketball player and yet kind of underrated for, you know, this menu of reasons. And this book, I mean, the people who are actually in the book, I mean, there's so much loving care that you are giving to them as you know, as a thinker about what their significance is, but also as a lover of the risks that they took as artists and as human beings. I mean, I don't know, was that a thing that you were actually going for too?
Well, yeah, because there's always the other thing, right? And this is how Josephine Baker is the real engine of the book. So, and it's funny, before we started, I was like, I hope I don't have to talk about why I dedicated the book to Josephine Baker, but now I'm like organically returning to that answer. Because Josephine Baker is someone who I was so fascinated by the fact that there is so little about her speech at the March on Washington, where she pulled up to the March on Washington in the uniform of the French Resistance and gave this singular, beautiful speech. And it is almost, it is difficult to find that history. Yeah. And so much of Josephine Baker's late career and performances are not as discussed in the cultural zeitgeist as the Josephine Baker as we know with the bananas or you know, doing the kind of things that she did as a younger performer. But I was so captivated by her performances in the 70s, towards the end of her life.
Where she could not
move as well, perhaps, but still could command an audience just by like directly telling them what she needed them to do. And they would do it, you know?
Yeah.
And so Josephine Baker to me felt more powerful then. She had honed her skills of not something beyond seduction even, you know, but just like otherworldly power that she could wield without even moving around the stage. And that does not, that gets kind of lost in the large scope of her life. And so much of this book was kind of following that path of what do I love about an already beloved person that perhaps doesn't feel like it's the most illuminated thing in their history? And how can I get to that? How can I get to some excitement about that?
I love that. And you've done it. Like, I mean, so many people in this book.
There are a lot of people in the book.
Have new light shown on them. We got to go because it's 8:12. But Hanif, congratulations. This book is great.
Thank you, Wesley.
It's a pleasure to read. It's a pleasure to reread. I've read things in this book maybe 4 times, in part just to see how you did it. In part just to feel the joy for these people that you feel for them yourself. I thank you for this. If for anybody like still with us who has not purchased this book, please do so immediately. And you, young man, I will talk to you later. Thanks everybody thanks, for Wesley. Coming out. I just want to say thank you to Benjamin Smith and Antonio Burkett for doing the sign language translation. We really appreciate you guys. And thanks everybody for coming out. Thanks Greenlight. Thanks BAM. Talk to you soon.
Bye everyone.